Well, good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church of Goodrich. Thank you so much for joining us this morning online. Our first song we're going to sing is called Blessed Be the Name. Sing with us this morning.
All praise to Him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave His Son for man to die that He might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more. And God the Father's own right hand, where angel hosts adore. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. On that last verse, His name I'll be, the Counselor, the Prince of Peace, of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, whose reign shall never cease. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen. Well, thank you for joining us again this morning. I trust that you were singing along with us. And it's good to have you following us here on our video this morning for our Sunday morning service. Today is Palm Sunday, and of course, a day that we remember the day where Jesus Christ made His triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And we celebrate that, rejoice in that, and what He was going to do in paying for our redemption, even this week as we celebrate. And so we're again thankful that you're joining with us, and I would encourage you to join with me in a word of prayer as we begin our service this morning. Let's pray. Father, we come to You this morning thanking You for Your wonderful name, the name above all names. And Lord, as we gather this morning, we pray that You would strengthen us. Lord, hold us in your almighty arms. And Lord, as we look into Your word this morning, that You would be glorified in what You've done for us in giving us the wonderful everlasting life and peace that's found only in Your name. Bless us now, we pray. Encourage our hearts in Your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's sing together again. Page number 386. We'll sing Without Him.
Without Him, I could do nothing. Without Him, I surely fail. Without Him, I would be drifting like a ship without a sail. Jesus, oh Jesus, do You know Him today? Do not turn Him away. Oh Jesus, without Him, how lost I would be. Without Him, I would be dying. Without Him, I'd be enslaved. Without Him, life would be hopeless. But with Jesus, thank God, I'm saved. Jesus, oh Jesus, do You know Him today? Do not turn Him away, oh Jesus. to thank him for so much, to praise him for, you see, he has been so good to me. When I think of what he's done and where he has brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. When I look around and see the good things that he's done for me, I know I'm unworthy of them all. And his blessings he freely gives, I owe my whole life to him. I've got so much to thank him for. I've got so much to thank him for, so much to praise him for, you see. He has been so good to me. When I think of what he's done and where he has brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. And sometimes while on this way I kneel and I stop and say, Lord, thank you for all you've given me. And one day I'll reach heaven sure, oh please let me kneel once more. I've got so much to thank him for. I've got so much to thank him for, so much to praise him for, you see. He has been so good to me. When I think of what he's done and where he has brought me from, I've got so much to thank him for. I've got so much to thank him for.
Amen. Well, that is a true statement. We have four, and if we begin to count, we would lose count. And so we do have so much, even in these trying times, we have so much to thank our Lord for. Well, I would encourage you at this time, if you haven't already, to grab your Bibles, if you would. And we're going to be opening God's Word here at First Baptist Church. I don't speak for long before we open God's Word. That is where truth is. It is truth, and we cling to that and hold to that every step of the way. So I would encourage you to take your Bibles. We're going to have a word of prayer. And we're going to dig into God's Word this morning on this Palm Sunday. Let's pray. Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, thanking you that there is just so much to thank you for and so much to praise you for and what you've done for us. Lord, I pray that as we meet this morning, Lord, that you would give us as a church, that you'd give us peace, that you'd give us comfort and strength. And Lord, that you and you alone would be glorified, that you would receive all the praise. We thank you for what you've done for us. We pray that you will just bless our time in your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I know I'm speaking this morning to specifically our church, a church that is that's hurting a bit. As you know, this past Friday, we lost one of our own. And one of the hardest things during this time is not being able to be together. That is very difficult for us, especially during this time. And you know, and though there's sorrow and there's grief, we rest in the hope that is offered by Jesus Christ. And as I was praying about what to preach this morning, I had something in mind, but after the events of Friday, a text just was not leaving my mind. I couldn't dismiss it, and we're going to look at that this morning. I think that's what the Lord has for us this morning. Last Wednesday, we looked at John chapter 14 on Wednesday night, and we looked at the peace that Jesus promised to give. This morning, we're going to be in John chapter 11. John chapter 11. And those who've been in church for any time, you know that John 11 is a beautiful passage, a beautiful text. And I hope it'll bring us some comfort and joy even today. You know, in the Gospel of John, really, there are only 7 recorded miracles. The Gospel of John has the least amount recorded, but something unique about each miracle that is recorded is each of them is confronting the audience and those who saw and those who witnessed to make a decision about Jesus Christ. They could not leave that miracle unchanged. They would have a choice to make in seeing the miracle. And in this passage right here in John chapter 11, we come to the last of the 7 miracles. This is the last of the 7 miracles recorded in the book of John. And then beginning in chapter 12, all the way to chapter 20, we have really the events of this week, the last week of Christ here on earth. And so in John chapter 11, verses 1 to 16, really the stage is set for one of the most well-known miracles of Jesus Christ, that is the raising of Lazarus from the dead. And this is very appropriate in the time frame because this is the last miracle, the last really major event that Jesus was a part of before his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And so this morning I want to look at 3 things to consider in the account of Lazarus. And I want to look at this, of course, at the angle of our church who is definitely hurting and has a wide range of feelings at this time. But I want to look at 3 things to consider this morning in the account of Lazarus and how what we can learn from them and what we can take from that as we navigate through continued these days. The first thing I want to look at in this passage is really the emotions. The emotions. Probably of all the Gospels, this chapter and these verses display for us the wide range of emotions that Jesus can produce in someone's heart, in someone's life. And beginning here in John chapter 11, I'm going to begin reading in verse 17. And we're going to look at some of the emotions we find in this text. It says that then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith to him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She saith unto him, Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which had come into the world. This first set of emotions is brought on by somebody by the name of Martha. Martha was Lazarus' sister. And Martha was an interesting character. We see her earlier in the Gospels as one who was busy about, working about and doing things for the Lord. And she was Martha was known, she had a heart to understand. Martha was one who was wanted to know. She was very inquisitive. She was one who was always seeking for the answers. And really Martha, in the midst of this sorrow, Martha begins a dialogue with Jesus Christ himself. And Martha's purpose in her questions and in her sorrow was really to get an understanding. You know, I think that's what we want during difficult times. We want to understand, why is this happening? What's going to be the result? And how am I going to fare through this difficulty? And so Mary gives these wide range of emotions. She's asking questions to God, why? Jesus, why is this? I know this is true, but I'm still hurting. Mary, on the other hand, continues the emotions. Look at verse 28. And when she had said so, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, The master is come and calleth for thee. Mind you, Mary and Martha had been waiting for Jesus for 4 days. They had been talking amongst themselves. They were over halfway through the seven-day grieving process of one who had passed, and Mary was grieving herself. And verse 29, as soon as she heard that, she arose quickly, came unto him. Now when Jesus was not yet come into town, verse 30, but was in that place where Martha met him, the Jews then which were with her in the house and comforted her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, she goeth unto the grave to weep there. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. Those few verses have a wide range of emotion, mostly sorrow and hurt. Mary was simply pouring out her heart to Jesus. She had some, I guess you could almost say, legitimate questions. Mary was truly wondering, why weren't you here? We'll look at that here in a moment. But can I tell you this morning, it's okay to pour out your heart to God. It's okay to give him your cares and your worries. It's okay to seek to know these things, but ultimately we must remember to trust in his promise. And Mary was not interested in carrying a dialogue. Mary was simply pouring out her heart, just like she did earlier and even later as she anoints the feet of Jesus and wipes it with her hair. Mary was not interested in a dialogue. She was interested in giving God her heart. And she just poured it out to him. Jesus continues with this range of emotion, and he says in verse 33 that he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. It says in verse 35, the famous verse, Jesus wept. The people who were around saw his sorrow. Verse 38, Jesus therefore again groaning in himself cometh to the grave. It was a cave and a stone lay upon it. Jesus was moved by the emotion of this scene surrounding the death of Lazarus. The idea of being groaned was deeply moved, deeply troubled. And really has the idea of groaning. It really has the idea of a little bit of anger too. Anger at the thought of death's sting. Why did Jesus weep, knowing and already having received the promise earlier in the chapter, that why did he weep knowing God would raise Lazarus? That's a question people always ask. Why did Jesus weep? He knew that Lazarus was going to be raised. You see, Jesus had a personal connection with friends on earth who were experiencing the result of sin. And although Jesus was sorrowful for his friends, he was even more sorrowful for the result that was brought on by Satan himself, and that is the result of death. Jesus was experiencing this firsthand before he himself would experience that later in the week. And so Jesus is seeing his friends suffer from the result of Satan's deceit. An early church father wrote this. He said, God wept because those who could be immortal, the devil made mortal. God wept because those who he had rewarded with every benefit and had placed under his power, those whom he had set in paradise among flowers and lilies without any hardships, the devil, by teaching them to sin, exiled from almost every delight. God wept because those who he had created innocent, the devil through his wickedness caused to be found guilty. Jesus wept is a beautiful thought that Jesus himself can relate with what we're going through. Even as a church, even today, Jesus can relate. Jesus knows. But not only were there many emotions, there were many questions during this time. Just reading this, as we read it earlier, Mary and Martha had a very interesting question, both of them. Perhaps this was what they had discussed in the 4 days waiting for Jesus. You know what it's like talking and commiserating with your friends and your family? You begin to think of all the what-ifs. You begin to think of all the things that could have happened, that would have happened, and how things would have transpired if something didn't take place or did. And so Mary and Martha both asked Jesus the same question. You see, Martha in verse 21, Martha said unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. Mary says the same thing in verse 32. She says, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. Both of these sisters really had this serious question in their heart. You know, sometimes we think the presence of suffering is the absence of God. But can I tell you that this morning it's really the opposite. It's in suffering we're able to feel God's presence the most. It's in suffering we're able to feel his arms around us the most. And even though Mary and Martha had just experienced great sorrow and great tragedy, Jesus was there to say, I'm here, I'm with you. William Ward says, we should be thankful for our tears. They prepare us for a clearer vision of God. I wear contacts. I just started wearing them the last few years. And something I quickly realized is that the only time they get irritated is when they're dry. And if you wear contacts, you know that's the same thing. That they must remain moist in order for you to maintain that vision. And in the same way, we must be thankful for those times that Jesus can have our hand in his and lead us through. So there were questions Mary and Martha had if you were here, but let's be reminded of the fact that just because we're suffering doesn't mean God's absent. Matter of fact, for the believer, that means God is ever present. There's another question Jesus asks in verse 34. If you have a red letter Bible, it sort of jumps out at you. And he said, where have ye laid him? Where have ye laid him? Jesus asked this question not because he didn't know, but because he was wanting clarity through their grief. He asks them to once again confront their sorrow. You see, you and I have a choice in how we deal with things. Some people flee. Some people choose to ignore. Some people confront it. And Jesus is doing just that to these ladies and the onlookers. He is asking them to confront their sorrow, meet it head on, to face it, not with fear, but with power he was about to display. A beautiful thought that Jesus Christ wants us to not just flee from those sorrows, but to confront them, to deal with them, and to go through them with him. So there were many questions in this passage, but one of the most encouraging things about this passage is found in the promises we see. Look at verse 23. Verse 23, Jesus says unto Martha, thy brother shall rise again. She continues, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. This is the fifth of the seven I ams found in the Gospel of John. Later on, we have he is the true vine. Earlier, we have he's the good shepherd. And so Jesus is giving this wonderful declaration that he gave to Mary and Martha, he gives to us today. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Now, what does that mean that Jesus says, I'm the resurrection? That is, whoso believes in me will live, whether he lives or dies. He will live. Because he is the resurrection, Jesus was about to display his power over death. He says, I am the resurrection. Whoever believes in me will live, even though they may die. He says, I am the life. Whosoever lives and believes in me will never die. What a beautiful thought. That every time Jesus is present, life is present. Death has no place in the presence of God. And we can be assured of that. Revelation 21:4 reminds us that in the new heaven and the new earth, there'll be no death or sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. And we're reminded of this wonderful fact that Jesus tells her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. The purpose of this miracle that is about to take place was to increase the faith of Jesus' followers. Just as Jesus had said, he was when he heard that Lazarus was sick, back in verse 4, Jesus says to them, he says, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son might be glorified thereby." It's a wonderful thought to be reminded of the fact that God hears our cry. God hears our care. And he wants to hear them. And he gives this wonderful promise that the greatest enemy we can know, death, will not have the final say for the believer. And in verse 44 to 43, we have the wonderful climax of the story, if you will. Jesus, in verse 40, Jesus said unto her, "Said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of God?" Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me." And then verse 43. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, which, by the way, that phrase, a loud voice, only appears a few times, a few of them, on the cross itself. And so Jesus cries with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." What words to hear. You probably heard some preachers say, and I tend to believe this, that if Jesus had not specified Lazarus, that everyone would have come forth because of his power over death. And so he cries, "Lazarus, come forth." Now the miracle wasn't over, because in verse 44, we see what took place. "And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus said unto them, Loose him and let him go." You know, every time when I think of this story, I my mind goes back to a scene I remember seeing in junior church, and just it was a very very interesting picture that I had in my mind of Lazarus almost being just sort of staggering out, almost looking a little scary and wondering what was happening. But Lazarus did not come out wobbling, did not come out disoriented or staggering around, but Lazarus came out fully alive and restored. A beautiful picture. But in this miracle, Jesus was giving a physical manifestation of a spiritual reality. You know, you and I, we look at the story and we might think, "Oh, that's wonderful. Good for Lazarus. What a beautiful thing to have seen." But Jesus here was going much deeper than this physical raising someone from the dead. We know that that's not the way God chooses to work in our day and age. But he was giving a physical manifestation of a spiritual reality that those who believe in Jesus Christ will live forever. You see, the joy in this story, these verses, the joy in this story is not Lazarus coming back to life. You say, isn't that the point of the story? No. And now, yes, it's a wonderful thing, but remember, Lazarus, years later, dies. So the joy, the beauty of this story is not about Lazarus coming back to life, but it's found in the realization that eternal life can be found in the one who raised Lazarus from the dead. You see, Jesus was just giving an illustration of the power he had and has over death. J. Boyd Nicholson, a writer for Our Daily Bread, gives a good thought on this. He says, "Standing before the grave of Lazarus, whose body was corrupting, the Lord demanded something of those who longed for a miracle. They might have questioned, 'Lord, you're going to raise him from the dead. Why not just speak and the stone rolled away? Why not just think it and it happens?' But there's a principle here that the Lord will not do by a miracle what we are to do by obedience." I'll say that again. The Lord will not do by a miracle what we are to do by obedience. Is there a stone he wants you to roll away, something he wants you to do, some hard attitude to yield to him? Someone perhaps you won't forgive, or unconfessed sin, some step of obedience that you are commanded to take. Can I tell you, he's waiting. He's waiting for you. It's ours to obey. It's his to do the miracle. You know, when I look at this story, I'm happy for Lazarus, and I'm sure his sisters were as well. Not everyone was happy with Jesus, if you continue reading. But I rejoice in the fact, not so much that Lazarus was raised from the dead, but that in the resurrection of Lazarus, we find hope we can have for eternity. Hope we can rest in each and every day. You see, God and God alone holds the keys to life and death. And because of that, he can speak those words with authority. Because he not only walked the road, but everything that was thrown at him, he conquered, even death itself. And because he lives, we can live also. I want to close with this poem by Olga Weiss. It's a wonderful thought. And I hope this is an encouragement to you, whatever you're going through, and even for our church, whatever you may be going through, as we even navigate through our own loss as a church. She says this, "The road is too rough," I said. "Dear Lord, there are stones that hurt me so." And he said, "Dear child, I understand. I walked it long ago." "But there's a cool green path," I said. "Let me walk there for a time." "No, my child," he gently answered me. "The green path does not climb." "My burden," I said, "is far too great. How can I bear it so?" "My child," he said, I remember the weight. I carried my cross, you know." "But," I said, "I wish there were friends with me who would make my way their own." "Oh yes," he said, "Gethsemane was hard to bear alone." And so I climbed the stony path, content at last to know that where my master had not gone, I would not need to go. And strangely then, I found new friends. The burden grew less sore. And I remember long ago, he went that way before. You see, God's not going to call you to walk a path that he hasn't walked already. And God is not going to lead you through a place where he will not sustain you by his ever strong arms. And so I would encourage you this morning, as we look at this account, when you read John 11, don't simply rejoice in the fact that Lazarus is raised. Rejoice in the beautiful thing that was displayed for us, that Jesus says, "I'm the resurrection." We look at death often with sorrow, but we can look at it through the lens of John 11 with joy, that we believe that Jesus Christ died and conquered death for us. So when he says the words, "I'm the resurrection and the life," he's not just saying that to sound encouraging. He's saying that because he conquered death. And you can too. And you can have hope in Jesus Christ, that those who've gone before, who've placed their faith in Christ, we will see again, but not just them. We will see our Savior face to face. I would encourage you this morning, if you have not placed your faith in Jesus Christ, he can give you the hope you're so desperately longing for. And for the believer, and even for those in our church, I would encourage you, let's keep our eyes fixed on him, fixed on the resurrection and the life. What a time of year to be reminded of the beautiful price that was paid for us on Calvary. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from every sin. So, friends, I would encourage you, turn to Christ, look to Christ, rely on Christ in this time. And just like Lazarus experienced that resurrection, you too, perhaps not physical resurrection here on earth, But when our time comes to go, we can have assurance that we can spend eternity in heaven. If you don't know for sure, fix that and make that right today. Call on his name. Call on the name of Jesus. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. To our church family, we love you. We are praying for you each and every day. Pray for each other. Pray for our families during this time, especially those experiencing loss. And let's, more than now than ever, be the church and come together and rejoice in the promises that God has given to us. Let's pray. Father in heaven, again, I come to you thanking you for your goodness. Lord, I thank you for the promises that you have given to us in your word. I thank you for the hope that we have that not everybody has. But Lord, you have given that hope and made it available to all who would believe. And so, Lord, I pray this morning for anybody who may be watching who has not placed their faith in Jesus Christ and have decided that they would give their life to you and that they would become a new creature. Lord, I pray that they would make that decision today. Lord, for our church family and those believers watching, Lord, I thank you for them. And Lord, we miss them. We miss them desperately. Lord, we long for the day when we can be together. And Lord, I pray that you would help us as a church to continue to love and encourage each other in the faith. Lord, that we would keep the faith. And Father, that we would find hope in your promise and that we can rejoice in that even today and even during these difficult times. We thank you for your goodness. We pray you'll continue to have your watch care over us. And Lord, that we would rely and trust in your way even when we can't see it clearly. We thank you for your goodness. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.